Good evening, good morning, good afternoon, everyone, and welcome. Thank you for joining today's career webinar. This program is being brought to you by the MIT Alumni Association. My name is Lourdes Melgar, and I am an MIT alum and I graduated in 1992 with a PhD in political science, course 17. I have also been a Wilhelm Fellow and a research affiliate at the Center for Collective Intelligence. Special greeting to my fellow MIT alumni, graduate alumni in the audience. I am joining you from Mexico City and will serve as your host and moderator for this event. I am a member of the Graduate Alumni Council, and our mission is to find meaningful ways for graduate alumni to connect with MIT and each other. We are very excited to have you all here with us today. As we get started, please drop in the chat where in the world you're joining us from. I can see you're already doing that, so thank you so much. Please note your MIT course and your class year so we can get a feel of who's together in the session today. For those of you in the audience who would benefit from closed captioning, that can be enabled now on your screen. Please note that the chat is open and the question feature turn on. The webinar will consist of different sections with the opportunities for questions at the end of each one and at the end of the program. If you resonate with a question in the Q&A, please feel free to help us out by upvoting what others have asked. We have a lot to get to, so let's jump in.
Thank you so much, Lourdes. I'm thrilled to be here and I cannot wait to chat with everyone. I'm seeing folks from 1997, 2014, 1974, and then all over the country and all over the world, which is fabulous. And so to kick things off, let's give a little love to your amazing team right here in Cambridge. And so I would love for you to come to the chat and send in some amazing love to Ellen, to Megan, to Jen. Everyone on the alumni side has been working super hard to bring you this session and everything else they have planned for the new year. Now, because it's 2024 and we're officially living in the future, you can obviously use the emoji button as you always have, but you could certainly come over to ChatGPT and generate a sonnet for the world's best alumni team. And I bet this would make the bard himself weep with joy if only he could see it today. So send in your emojis, send in your AI poetry, show a lot of love to your amazing team at MIT. A little bit about your speaker tonight. So I'm coming to you having had this really lucky experience of going from a kindergarten teacher in New York City to working at Google and LinkedIn and Apple. And I currently lead the marketing team at Khan Academy. And it's in that capacity that my boss, Sal Khan, came to me about maybe 15 or 16 months ago and said, Jeremy, I just had a chat with the folks over at OpenAI. And they showed me something that I think is gonna change the future of our species forever. And I was like, wow, Sal, I know that we're pretty gullible here in Silicon Valley, but this takes the cake. And then I used ChatGPT for myself for the very first time, even before it was released to the public. And I saw instantly that Sal was right. This was gonna be huge. So I've made it my mission as a former career coach to take all these great tools and work with great alums like yourself to leverage them to land the jobs you love. But I have to warn you, because we are operating at the cutting edge here, this is not gonna be your standard webinar. You know what I mean? Kind of do a little multitasking, do a little bit of this and a little bit of that. No way. I'm gonna ask for you to learn deeply in three powerful ways. The first way is I'm gonna be throwing some pop quizzes at you. And you probably figured you were done with pop quizzes after graduating from MIT. But one last time, I'm going to ask you to come to the chat and answer those in the name of learning. Number two is, if you really want to learn deeply, I would love for you to volunteer for one of three live role plays. Because if you do, you will win a free copy of my new AI for Job Searching book sent right to you in Cambridge, in California, in Shanghai, wherever you might be. And then third and finally, no matter what you do tonight, just make the most of the session, not just by looking at my screen, but by doing everything on your screen, and that way you burn these techniques into your muscle memory. So with that said, Time for the first pop quiz. For anyone out there who's ever looked for a job, which I assume is pretty much everyone in the audience, what would you say has been the hardest part of the search for you? Is it A, that first step, finding that right role? B, translating that focus into an interview with a great resume and a great cover letter? Or C, walking out of that interview with a job offer in hand, having aced that final stage? So A, B, or C, what tends to give you the most stress as you head into this job search process? So I'm seeing a lot of different answers here. An A from Takashi, a C from Denise, a B from Austin, and Gemma, I like, says A, B, C, absolutely. Every one of these stages can be daunting. But what I would argue to you is that no matter which stage is the most stressful and anxiety provoking, we've all been there. Because we've all had that moment that I called the blank screen problem, where it's 3 o'clock in the morning and we're staring at our blank Word document or our blank Google Doc. And that demonic little cursor is just staring us in the eye saying, hey, you don't know what to do. You are stuck. Maybe it's because you're not sure what to do with your career or how to write a great resume or how to prepare for that interview tomorrow. Well, wherever you're feeling stuck, what I'm going to argue to you is that AI is not a replacement for career coaches and great strategy and great conversations, but it is a really killer way to get unstuck when you're feeling weighed down. And so with these new tools, I want to walk you through every stage in the process to show you how to get unstuck and to move forward with bravado. So let's start with that first stage. You know, clearly there were a lot of folks in the audience who believe in the same thing that I believe in, which is that it's so critical to start your search with focus, to have a clear North Star. Now, why do you think that's the case? Is it A, because it speeds up your search and you get a job offer sooner? B, because it leads to more success, so more job offers, more conversion? Or is it C, because it actually leads to more satisfaction, you're happier at the end of the day with the job that you do take? So right back to the chat, A, B, or C, and I'm seeing a lot of great answers here. A C from Jacinda, a B from Steve, an A, B, C from Hillary. And Hillary, you nailed it. I know others did as well. Turns out that every single stage of the process is enhanced with focus. Whether you're looking at data from the government, from startups, from the world's largest HR organization, when you search with focus, you just search better. So the question then becomes, how do I get that focus? And to give away the very first copy of this book, I want you to chat right into the chat right now and say, I'm in, Jeremy. Whoever chats in first will get this first book and a step-by-step path to use AI to find your perfect path. So let's see, who's gonna be our first volunteer? Oh my goodness, so many amazing folks. I believe that Richard Baboni was first. So Richard, feel free to unmute your line. I would love to have you come join us, and I will definitely give you the ability to do so in 1 second. Welcome to the session.
Thank you, Jeremy. It's nice to have the opportunity.
Yeah, likewise, likewise. And Richard, tell me a little bit about yourself in terms of what did you study at MIT? What have you been up to since then? And then where are you right now in your career?
Well, I studied MIT a long time ago. I graduated back in 84. I studied mechanical engineering. I went on to do a lot of different things, but to make it short, I wound up getting my MBA in Italy. I lived and worked in Italy for 10 years and have been in executive management for 30 years. Now I'm in transition again at 62, looking to reinvent myself once again and, you know, trying to understand how to use the most modern tools to help me in that effort.
I love that, Richard. And Richard, I'm so happy that you volunteered, because I was talking with another group this morning and I heard some executives say, hey, I know it's so important to find your focus when you're 21 coming out of MIT, but what about when you're 61? And the reality is, no matter where you are in your career, it's always the right time to think about what's right for you. And so Richard, let's make this happen. Start by telling me a little bit about your experience with AI so far. Have you ever tried it for any of these career questions?
I've played around with AI just a little bit, but not for career questions specifically yet.
Okay, well, just so you know, even though I know you're a little new to the space, you're getting so much love from the brass rat wearers of the world. I'm seeing emojis, I'm seeing so many people saying, go Richard. So you've got a lot of support there. Now, Richard, if you use ChatGPT at all, if you put in a question like, what should I do with my career? What kind of answer do you expect to get back?
Not the answer you're looking for. I've learned that you have to really make a very detailed prompt.
That's right. Because, like, what you're going to get back is going to be okay, kind of like a blog post on Google you might find, but not detailed and not specific. And
Right.
I would argue that the real power of AI is to go beyond the platitudes and the generalities and give us specific advice for our specific challenges. So, like you said, let's start with specificity. So, say, I'm an MIT grad with a background in mechanical engineering. So, we're going to start there. Now, what I'm curious about is if you could imagine the world as consisting of these Venn diagram bubbles. One bubble is the world of work, what you can get paid to do, what employers want you to do. And another bubble is yourself. What makes you special? What are your superpowers? So tell me a bit about yourself, Richard. What do you love doing? What are you great at doing?
I love helping people realize their full potential. That's what I do. My goal as a manager is, it's not about me, it's about my team.
Such a great place to start. And then what about the kind of work you love doing in terms of, do you love driving projects forward? Do you love solving challenges, analysis? Like, what kind of work really motivates you?
I've been mostly in general management roles, so I've worn a lot of different hats, and I like being hands-on, and I've worked primarily in smaller to mid-sized companies.
Beautiful. And then finally, is there any kind of like domain that you're especially drawn to, whether it's sustainability, AI, or anything else under the sun that again really speaks to you as a unique individual?
Right. Up until now, I've been looking to kind of make a transition because historically I've been in more, let's say, companies that were focused on consumer product and some luxury good items and other consumer goods. And I'd like to get away from the goods and more into something that's, helping people in a broader sense.
Okay, I like to move away from CPG, consumer packaged goods, towards helping people. And that's great. Now, obviously, this is the kind of thing that's going to take a little bit of self-analysis, self-reflection. But if you can even feed ChatGPT a couple of sentences about where you're coming from, all you need to say is the magic prompt that follows. What are 10 specific job titles that could be a good fit for my skills and interests? Now, this is the interactive part. Obviously, you're going to see Richard doing this, and that's awesome. However, I would love for you to try this on your side. So I'm putting the prompt right in the chat. And whether you like ChatGPT or Bard or Copilot or any of the other tools, just give it a shot right now. See what you discover. So check this out, Richard. Compared to that original one that was so focused on, just go through the process and learn from your experiences. This is speaking the language of recruiters. Here are the exact things that we would love to hire you for. And now it's up to you to decide if these are a good fit. So, Richard, as you see these bold-faced job titles scroll on the screen, everything from working inside a company to starting a company to working in a nonprofit, is there anyone that you're a little intrigued by and you want to know more?
I like the idea of being an HR kind of director or a consultant or maybe even a nonprofit executive director.
Yeah. So say, tell me more about number seven and number nine. Now, I want you to get really selfish here, Richard. I know a lot of times all the advice is, oh, focus on the employer and what they need, but I want you to focus on you and what you need. What do you need to know about these jobs? What's going to make you happy or drive you crazy in these jobs? What should we ask ChatGPT?
Oh, wow. Really like to find an environment that's a real team environment where people are genuinely collaborating and looking for continuous improvement, continuous growth on the personal level, not just on the bottom line
Yeah.
level.
Yeah. And so obviously you could ask anything from, what's the day-to-day like? What skills are important? What backgrounds do they hire for? All the way to what's the work-life balance like? What's the salary range like? And so you're going to put that in. And again, I want everyone to be a little selfish here. And really do that double click. where it's not just one sentence, but actually a whole sort of spectrum of pieces of information to give you a taste for what this work is like. Now, I have to admit, Richard, the big dark side of doing this work on AI is it tends to make us forget about the real world and the fact that if you're part of the MIT network, you have literally hundreds of thousands of fellow alums that you could be reaching out to learn from. So Richard, if you wanted to be an executive director or an HR leader, who should you be talking to out in the real world?
Yeah, that's a great question, because in my experience, all my jobs have been found more through networking than any kind of job boards.
Yeah, and there's a real sort of win-win here, which is if you start reaching out just based on curiosity, chances are the people that you start to meet will then become the referrers, maybe even your future bosses, once you join that organization. So it's definitely feeding two birds with one scone, as we say here at Khan Academy, because we're a nonprofit ourselves. That being said, let's go over to LinkedIn and let's search specifically for MIT. And what I want you to focus on here, and I'm going to give you all the link in a second, is this little tab called Alumni. And if you come here to the product that my team built when I was at LinkedIn, again, you have access to almost 250,000 MIT alums that you can search in any way. So Richard, between HR and being an executive director of a nonprofit, which is more intriguing to you?
Let's try the exec director of nonprofit.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that would be a great way to take all the leadership skills you've built up and actually apply it for good out there in the world. So we're going to find everyone who wears a brass rat and is also an ED. And then we're going to come down here. We're going to see where they are. So executive director at the Uniswap Foundation, executive director at Woodnext Foundation, lots of interesting things, even executive director at Citizen Robotics. That's kind of cool. Let's click on Tom's profile. And Tom, if you're in the crowd right now, let us know. Now, if you want to strike up a conversation with Tom, I know that you know, Richard, it's all about going to more, going to connect, adding a note. The only problem is we're right back to that blank screen problem. How do we possibly send a great message to Tom, especially if we're feeling a little nervous about this? So again, if it's 3 o'clock in the morning, Richard, and you're feeling like there's this moment of crisis, how do I break through feeling stuck? Who could help you write the best message possible?
Go back to ChatGPT.
That's right. And by the way, I just wanted to shout out, this is the beauty of having the whole alumni network in this call right now, is that Amrit said, I'm an executive director. Happy to talk, Richard. So obviously start networking even before you get to LinkedIn with fellow alums right now in the chat. That being said, just to reiterate, if we come to ChatGPT and we say, write a LinkedIn connection request, it'll be happy to do it. There's only one problem. It's terrible. It's too long. It's too generic. It's all the things that are going to make this fellow alum be totally turned off. On the other hand, watch this. This is a killer technique now. If you grab Tom's entire profile, top to bottom, all the way back to his time at MIT, and then you come over here and say, rewrite that message with a focus on a specific alum. You say, keep it under 300 characters, and personalize it to his profile. Look what you can do. Just by pasting it in, it's almost like you're doing like an OS upgrade on ChatGPT, because now it knows about the specific individual. So again, the prompt is right here. I want everyone to try this out. And look what we get back this time. Instead of a terrible message that's completely useless, now it's focused on what you have in common and what you want to learn from him. Way better. So Richard, you have been fabulous, but I have one last question for you. When the big day arrives and you're ready to chat with Tom, potentially to open up the door to a brand new career, what can you possibly ask Tom to decide if his Venn diagram bubble aligns with yours?
Well, I guess it would be more like the things that really drives him, that motivates him, the values he has that keeps him engaged and excited about getting up and doing this work every day.
Yeah. So you want to know what it's like to be in his shoes, what it feels like to go through the routines that he's going through. In other words, kind of doing a Vulcan mind meld with this other person to see if that feels right for you. And watch how ChatGPT can help. You know, I think we've all had that experience where we've got an informational interview coming up. So we ask Google, and we find some questions that are okay. You know, they could be worse, but again, they're still generic. And we can do so much better here in 2024 just by going to ChatGPT and saying, generate 10 questions for Tom to help me decide if his path is right for my skills and interests. Now, here's the interesting question. Richard, do we have to remind ChatGPT who Tom is and what his path is?
Because you already put that info in there.
That's right. Do we have to remind ChatGPT who you are, Richard, and what your skills and interests are?
If we haven't done that yet, we do.
That's right. If we hadn't done it, we would. But that was literally the first thing we shared, right? It was like, I'm a mechanical engineer by training, and I have this experience, you know, building teams. And right. So the beautiful difference, this is like a mental model shift, is we're no longer in the world of Google, where every search is an independent blank slate. Now we're doing more like a conversation where there's an original foundational layer of data that we share, and it grows over time. So look what we get back. These questions are both super specific about Tom and his experience, but they also speak to the things that you care about. You have experience with technology. You have experience with manufacturing. You have experience with mechanical engineering. And ultimately, you get to decide now, are those Venn diagram bubbles aligned? Or is there another one out there that would be a better fit? And Richard, I got to give you a copy of this book tonight, not just because you've helped yourself, but because you've helped every single MIT alum sort of say, hey, it's not about just finding a job. It's about building a career, building a life that I love. And I think that's a worthy pursuit here in the new year. I cannot thank you enough, Richard.
Awesome, Jeremy. Thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
Oh, my pleasure. Beautifully done. Okay, so Richard, I'm going to follow up later to tell you how to get access to the book. But in the meantime, I want your classmates to follow in your footsteps in two important ways. Number one, if you've got any questions about anything we just covered, put those in the Q&A right now. The right tools, the right prompts, the right techniques. It's all fair game. And again, I'm going to take them based on upvotes. So if you see a question you really like, please upvote it in the Q&A and I'll take those first. Now, while you put those questions in, I want to share with you a little crash course on the right way to use these tools. Because unfortunately, sitting here in Silicon Valley, we get all this hype, all this nonsense about you've got to be a prompt engineer and you have to spend 1,000 hours working on these tools. And nothing could be further from the truth. It turns out there are only three things to be super effective. And to make it easy to remember, I'm going to give you a mnemonic, GPT. So G stands for generic, as in ChatGPT is a great generic tool. However, there are some tools that are better for other jobs. As an example, let's say that you were coming back to ChatGPT and said, hey, what is the salary range for EDs in Cambridge in 2024? Well, it might seem like a very easy question, but for ChatGPT, it's actually really hard because it just doesn't have any current data. We're already 2 years out of date. On the other hand, if you were to come to Copilot by Microsoft and put in that exact same question, this time you get the really beautiful answer of, we searched the web, we discovered all these things out there in the world, and here is the cutting edge data that you need. So whenever you're looking for anything that's current, come to Copilot, come to Google Bard. They're both hooked up to the internet, which is what you want. Okay, number two is because we're all coming from this academic world, that's what binds us together. We know that there are certain applications where it's not enough to say, hey, ChatGPT told me so, trust me. So if you're in a situation like that, maybe you're debating, you know, what does the research say about one page versus two page resumes, always a hot topic in the world of career coaches. Well, ChatGPT is happy to go on at length about all of its opinions, but we have no idea where that data is coming from, completely unsourced. On the other hand, if we go over to our friend Perplexity and we paste in that same question, this time we get the academic gold standard, footnotes, citations, all the original sourcing to decide if this content is legitimate. So if you need a really high threshold for truth, head over to Perplexity. So no matter which tool you choose, the next step is to prompt it the right way. And again, the easiest thing to remember is that simple motto, garbage in equals garbage out. If you've got a generic prompt, you're going to get a generic response. Now, you don't need to write 3 pages of prompting, but if you can be specific in two powerful ways, you're going to get great results. Number one, Be specific about the inputs. Here's my resume. Here's the job description I'm excited about. And then be specific about the outputs. How does my resume differ from this job description? Tell me all the keywords I'm missing, or suggest three job titles. That gives you way better outcomes. And then no matter what you get back originally, I know this is going to sound crazy, but do not hesitate to talk back to the machine. We are not living in a world of Google anymore where we just have to accept whatever we get. Instead, we say, you know what? That was a good start, but I know you can do better, ChatGPT. Make it shorter, make it more engaging, use more data. And the more you push back, the better the final outcome. So GPT is the path to success. Let's take some questions from the Q&A. Blake says, I will want to know at the end of this, what is the current trend for hiring managers and HR screening for ChatGPT generated content in any of the application process? So it's funny you mentioned that, Blake, because this morning I literally wrote a LinkedIn post about that. And what I wanted people to understand, especially as a hiring manager myself, is that as a hiring manager, what is my job? What am I trying to accomplish? I am trying to find someone who can do more with less, especially here in 2024, as the economy changes. As a result, I am not focused on trying to catch you using AI. In fact, I'm going to expect you to use AI once you join my team. That's how we're going to get efficiencies. That's how we're going to deliver better results. And so it would be highly ironic for a hiring manager who expects you to use this tool to also ban you from using it in your application process. So the reality is, yes, it's true that on campus, there are probably tons of MIT professors who are trying to catch their students essentially cheating on essays and things like that. But out here in the real world, out here in the hiring world, all I care about is, can you use the best tools to get the best results? And so I would argue, Blake, if you want to make a bet today that within 2 years, job descriptions all across the world will call more often for generative AI prompting experience than they will for Microsoft Office. It's going to become table stakes faster than you might even expect. Great question. Let's go next to Celine. Are there any privacy issues with copying and pasting personal info? Yes, Celine. We will cover those in the very next section. Stay tuned. And then one last question before we move on. Steven says, are there significant differences in using AI for job searching with ChatGPT 3.5 versus 4? So I've got great news for you, Steven. The first one is that you do not have to pay OpenAI to use GPT-4 because it turns out that Microsoft is giving it away for free. So if you come back to Copilot, and again, the link is right here, what you can do is you can actually try out GPT-4 and compare it to the results with 3.5. Now, I will tell you, I am a speed nut. I hate the fact that when you use GPT-4, everything just feels slow. So if you ask one of these questions, it kind of takes its sweet time giving you an answer. Versus 3.5 is blazing fast, as you saw. And so I would say that, especially when you're learning these new tools, you want to get as many reps in as possible. And the faster you can get a response, the faster you can learn. However, it is true that GPT-4 was trained on more data points than GPT-3.5. So it does tend to be a little more precise. But again, in my personal trade-off, I prefer speed over like 100% perfection, especially because, as you're going to see in the next section, it's not about having ChatGPT write your resume for you. It's about having it upgrade your existing resume. And so that's a perfect segue into our next topic, which is, let's say that you have done what Richard has done. You've identified your perfect role. You've started to apply for these jobs, but all of a sudden you are completely shut out. Every single application is met with crickets and you never hear back. What's going on behind the scenes? Well, it turns out that even though we as job seekers are very excited about our focus, there is one cause of death that is more predominant than any other in terms of why your resume was rejected. What do you think it is? Is it A, because it didn't fit the role? B, because it violated CAR format, you know, challenge, action, result, as you may have learned from the career services team? Or is it C, because it did not fit on a single page? And I am very happy to say, Ellen and Megan, that everyone is saying A. I see an A from Helen, from Christian, from Sandy. And indeed, that is the truth. Because here is the interesting contrast. We as job seekers feel so emboldened all of a sudden. We have all these awesome tools, all this AI. But here's the reality. On the other side of the screen, recruiters and hiring managers have been using AI to screen your resume for over two decades. As an example, when I was a recruiter at Teach for America at the turn of the millennium, we were inundated with applications, more than 1,000 on average per job. As a result, with our scarce nonprofit resourcing, we couldn't afford to read every last resume, but we used our applicant tracking system's built-in AI to tell us which resumes matched the job and focus on those. And what makes me so happy here in 2024 is that finally we as job seekers have our own AI to level the playing field. So if you want to make sure that your resume aces the ATS test and you pass through with flying colors, go ahead and chat in right now. Say, I'm in. Whomever's first gets that next copy of the book. So here we go. I'm going to see who's first right in the chat. And it looks like it's Leslie Ricklean. So Leslie, I'm going to give you the microphone. And Leslie, feel free to go ahead and unmute. And I'm excited to chat with you. Welcome, Leslie.
Hello there.
Hi, how are you?
I am having a blast.
Oh, thank you. That's great. That's great. I'm so happy. And Leslie, throw down the gauntlet for me. As long as you're having a blast, tell me what would make you super excited as far as a next step in your career.
A role that allows me to both exercise my brain, exercise my humanity, and be a great parent. At a livable salary in Massachusetts. It kind of feels like a holy grail.
Oh my goodness. I know it sounds like a unicorn job. Could it possibly exist? Well, tell me this. Obviously, we want to make sure all those factors are in place, but is there a specific industry, a specific job title that you're especially drawn to?
I've been in strategy consulting for the last 5 years and I really enjoy it. I think staying in kind of the strategy world, but not necessarily the consulting world.
Aha. So maybe going in-house and serving as like an internal advisor on strategy versus flying around and running around for another firm. Is that right?
Yeah.
Okay. I love that. And so let's think about it maybe through a tech lens. You know, in the tech world, we tend to call that role business operations because, of course, in the tech world, we have to be crazy about everything with our own language. So let's start by thinking, if you were an employer, so a hiring manager or a recruiter at a firm that's going to hire an amazing biz ops professional, how would you train the applicant tracking system, Leslie, to know what to look for on your resume?
Sorry, one moment. Go for it, Leslie. My son just walked in the room. Give me one moment.
No worries. And Leslie is demonstrating exactly what she said. She needs time for her family and time to do awesome work. So as Leslie's taking care of that, I will just tell you, the source of truth for any applicant tracking system for the employer's AI is always the job description. And I know that job descriptions are painful and awkward, but hiding inside those bullet points is hiring gold. So let's do this. Let's say business operations job, Boston. And we'll find a specific job. So here's senior manager for business operations at Klaviyo. And inside this job description is all the stuff they're hungry for. We need someone with experience with SaaS, with SQL, with Google Suite, on and on and on. So what we want to do, and Leslie, just let me know when you're ready.
I'm here.
Okay, awesome. Leslie, how would you like to basically boil down this completely overridden, completely crazy job description to just the keywords that matter and have your own cheat sheet?
That sounds amazing.
Okay, so we're going to cut through this because, you know, I'm a working parent myself. My kids are actually running around. I'm in the room over there. And I know that as parents, we don't have a lot of time to deal with a lot of fluff. So let's get down to brass tacks. So here we go. We're going to say, what are the top 15 most important skill keywords in this JD? Now you're going to start to see some patterns emerge, which is with copying and pasting, almost anything is possible in this tool because we're feeding it the information it needs. So again, the prompt is right there in the chat. Feel free to try that out. And for you, we now have that top 15 list, everything from project management and strategic consulting to data analysis and SQL. So that's a good start. But Leslie, I promised you specificity. How would you like to know how you are doing on this cheat sheet?
Yes, please.
Hey, I'm going to ask a little favor and feel free to say no. Is it okay if I pull up your LinkedIn profile, not to criticize it, but to shower it with love?
No showering necessary, but yes,
Okay.
of course.
Spoken like a true MIT alum. You just want the truth. So everyone, you got to send so much love to Leslie in the chat right now. It's one thing to raise your hand, but to share your profile with your entire alumni community, that is MIT love right there. So we're going to pull up Leslie's profile and we're going to run it through the algorithm the exact same way that the applicant tracking system would. So here's Leslie's profile. And again, we're going to grab all that text, everything from the headline at the very top down to the skills at the bottom. And that's what the ATS is looking through when it looks through your resume or your profile. So we say, which of those keywords are missing from my LinkedIn profile? Again, we're just going to paste it in as is. No coding, no formatting. I want you all to try this. The prompt is right there in the chat for you. And then we have our moment of truth. Here's what Leslie's doing great. She's nailed 8 of these keywords, but 7 are missing. So big question, Leslie. Of these 7 skills, do you actually have experience with some of them already?
Yeah.
Probably all of them, right?
About half.
Or about half. Okay, which is pretty good. And I want to be really clear, by the way. If you had to guess, Leslie, what do you think is a good match rate when you are applying for these jobs? Do you want to be 100% qualified, 80% qualified? What do you think makes recruiters happy?
I don't know. Probably 80%+.
Yeah, that would make sense, right? Why wouldn't you want someone who's, you know, pretty darn qualified? Well, it turns out that TalentWorks has done an experiment on this where they submitted all these variations of resumes that were more or less qualified. And the sweet spot was not 100% or even 80%. It was 50%. What could explain that, Leslie? Why would a recruiter, all else being equal, prefer a candidate who only matches 50% of the keywords versus someone who matches 100%?
People probably overinflate their ability.
Yeah, so basically a little bit of BS detection. Or think about it this way. When does a recruiter say that their job is done? Is it enough just to bring great candidates into interviews? Or do they have to get bodies in the seats?
Probably bodies in the seats.
That's right. Because you could bring in amazing people to interview, and maybe they're yawning so much in the interview because they're so bored that they blow it. Or maybe they get the offer and they decline it because they could do the job in their sleep. Versus someone who's 50% qualified, well, they're dangerous enough to make a big impact on day one, but hungry enough to actually take the job and keep on pushing. So this is the sweet spot for getting that right body into the right seat. So what that means is, I don't want anyone out there saying, oh, I don't match every keyword, therefore I can't apply. 50%, 70%, that's great. Now, just to do an example here, Leslie, of these 7 keywords, which one do you have the strongest background with? Stakeholder buy-in, beautiful. And probably the reason there's a mismatch is you would probably never think to use that exact language in your resume or your profile. But of course, this outdated 20-year-old AI from the employer side is not doing a lot of fuzzy logic. It's looking for a verbatim match. And so if you were to say to ChatGPT, take skill number 3, totally blowing that one there, take skill number 3 and generate 3 potential ways to add to my profile. Check out what happens. And this is really sort of the big sea change with AI versus something like Alexa or Siri. It can actually be a little bit creative. You can come up with ways to get credit for it under your achievements, your skill section, all these different places. But the only dark side is, what would happen, do you think, Leslie, if you were to take a recommendation from ChatGPT and just copy and paste it right into your profile or right into your resume? How could that lead to your total doom during the interview process?
During the interview process, presumably they'd ask me about it. So I need to be able to speak to the skill in the same type of detail as would show up on my LinkedIn page.
That's right. And so if we have a hallucination here, no hiring manager in the world will say, oh, don't worry about it, Leslie. It's okay. AI led you astray. You are still responsible for your own application. And that means, because of these hallucinations, we've got to be really careful when we pull something out of AI and put it into our documents. With that being said, Leslie, you have been a fabulous volunteer today. Would you mind if I assign you one last homework assignment? I know you probably thought you were done with that when you graduated from MIT, but I'm going to promise you this is the most important homework you will ever do.
Sure.
Hey, so Leslie, I'm going to give you the homework of just getting credit for the things you're already awesome at. And so when you have a moment, come over to your profile, come over to the resume, and just make sure that the whole world knows that you are as awesome as we know you are. And Leslie, you rock this. I cannot thank you enough.
Awesome. Thank you so much. This is incredibly helpful. I'm really excited to do this on my own later.
Totally my pleasure. I know it's going to be tough because you got to wait for the kids to be asleep and all of that. But using these tools, you can get it done efficiently and get back to the important things in life. Thank you so much, Leslie. All right. So with that said, again, I would love to take some questions, especially about the dark side of AI. So put those in the Q&A, upvote the ones you like. And while you put in those questions, I'm going to take you on a little tour of all the way that AI can screw you over. And again, I've got a little mnemonic for you. I'm calling it the ABCs. So A is for accuracy. And we were just talking about this. I think the really insidious part about AI is it looks so good at first glance. So if you say, write a resume for a career coach, bullets 1 through 3, 1 through 5, they all look great, but we might skip over bullet number 8, pastoral care, because we might not be looking carefully. And of course, the hard thing about this black box is not even OpenAI's engineers can explain where these things are coming from. So we have to be the ones to be responsible for looking out for them. So always look out for accuracy. B is for bias. And so one of the biggest biases that we have to be careful about, especially in a job searching context, is that temporal bias that we were alluding to. You know, imagine you have a big interview at Google tomorrow. So as a savvy MIT alum, you generate a SWOT analysis, strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats, and you get something back that looks pretty good. But oh, wait, there's something missing from this threats list. Namely, ChatGPT itself is now the biggest threat to Google. And of course, ChatGPT doesn't know about itself because it didn't exist at the time that it was trained. So I know that's mind-bending, but that is one of the challenges of these tools. And then third and finally, there's that piece that was alluded to in the question before, confidentiality. Now, we've all heard about that poor Samsung engineer who lost his job because some non-public information that he put into the model showed up on a competitor's screen. If you want to avoid that same fate, what I want everyone to know about is ChatGPT incognito mode. Specifically, if you come into the lower left-hand corner, click on your profile, and then come to settings and beta, you will find a data control section. And by turning off chat history and chat training, you make sure that ChatGPT isn't saving your data, and it's certainly not incorporating it into its model so it can make money off of you. So if you want to have that peace of mind, make sure to turn that off. Okay, with that being said, let's take some questions from the Q&A starting at the top. So Victor says, I want to know if there's a way for ChatGPT to help me customize an existing CV for a particular job description. Yes, Victor. The process that we just went through is the one that I want you to get used to using. And notice what I did not do. I did not say generate a CV, because then you get a really robotic, really boring one that probably has tons of hallucinations. Instead, I started with an existing CV or an existing LinkedIn profile in this case, and I said, review it. And by the way, we only really touched the tip of the iceberg, but you could say, review my CV and suggest 5 ways to add more quantitative data. One of the things that we learned from eye tracking studies of recruiters is that our eyes are really drawn to quantitative impact. 10% increase, $20 million. And so if you want to figure out ways to get more of that data in there, you can paste in your CV. And what it will do is instead of rewriting your CV, it'll give you feedback. Here are better ways to get credit for the incredible impact you drove. Great question, Victor. Okay, next to Michael. Discriminatory practices, ageism, for example, are prohibited when humans are involved in resume screening. Yet when AI is used on the corporate side to do this, are companies able to dodge the employment anti-discrimination laws? Great question, Michael. So I want to be clear that even though companies are using AI, and they have been for 2 decades, to review your keywords and your skills, they are not using it the way that ChatGPT might be used, where you could say, look through 100 resumes and just choose 2 people to interview. Instead, it's a mere filter that helps recruiters basically triage a larger list. And so it's possible that there may be some unscrupulous folks who are using it in ageist ways. But in general, it actually favors people with a little more experience, because the more keywords, the more skills, the more experience, the more your match score goes higher and higher, as opposed to someone who's just starting out. So at least that generation of AI is actually a little bit in favor of more senior candidates. But you're right, we have to be very wary of that with everything that comes next. Great question, Michael. And then one last question from Alan. Alan says, how do you know when something has fallen out of GPT's window? I know that different LLMs have different size windows. So what Alan is referring to, and I love this question, is that basically each one of these different models and each one of these different platforms can contain more or less information before it starts to forget. And one of the things that another tool called Claude was very well known for, and I'll put in Claude over here, is that their window was actually superior to ChatGPT 3.5. That being said, as far as I know from my own testing, GPT-4 does tend to have a pretty large window, again, because of the power and size of the model. So I would argue that's pretty much close to best in class, maybe with Claude as a close second. That being said, if others have other ones that they really recommend, definitely put it in. Although I will say, people have pasted entire books into Claude and GPT-4, and it's been able to digest them. And so that just shows you those windows are pretty darn big. Great question, Alan. I love that. Okay, time for my final question for you. And that is, at the end of the day, when you are ready to close the deal and get that job, what is the last thing standing in your way, according to a survey of 2,000 bosses? In other words, what is the number one interviewee mistake? Is it A, weak handshake, you know, that limp noodle in your hand? B, utter lack of knowledge about the company and the role? Or C, that dreaded Mona Lisa half smile, non-smile that sinks more job seekers than anything else? Now I'm seeing a B from Ellen, a B from Mark. Wafa says ABC, it's everything under the sun. And it turns out the answer is B. Hiring managers just cannot stand it when people come in and waste their time. So how do you get ready for prime time, especially if you're in a compressed hiring season where you might have 3 interviews all in 1 week? How do you get ready? To give away the final copy of the book and to close out this session in style, I need one last brave volunteer, and this time it's going to be Priya. So Priya, I'm going to give you the ability to turn on your microphone, and let's do this for the benefit of everyone out there. All right, here we go. All right, allowed to talk. Priya, you have the microphone. Feel free to click that little icon on your screen and welcome Priya.
Hey there, how's everyone doing?
Hey Priya, how are you?
I am doing well, really enjoying the session.
Good, good. Priya, tell us a little bit about yourself. What did you study at MIT? What have you been up to?
Actually, I'm a spouse of an MIT alum, and he is traveling for work, and I am looking for work. So there you go.
Hey, I love it. Well, I got to tell you, I'm only related to MIT by marriage. My father-in-law graduated from MIT in 69. So I totally get it. I have to say, I'm a little bit envious of all these folks with their brass rats. But you and I can bond here a little bit. So Priya, tell me this. What kind of job would you be excited for? Where are you potentially interviewing in terms of your next opportunity?
So I am looking for a business partner role, and I'm an HR person, and I describe myself as the business partner first with some HR skills. So that's where I'd be looking. I'm looking specifically in the Boston area. I'm not relocatable. Industry agnostic for the most part, just a few different businesses, like maybe a cigarette manufacturer would be a no-no, just from a personal value proposition basis. But otherwise, industry agnostic, Boston specific, business partner role where I can be deeply entrenched with the business.
Well, I love that. I love that focus. And also I love the fact that because you're coming from an HR background, you already get all these things. You understand that there's this whole other world of recruiters and talent acquisition that every job seeker should know about. And so let's do this. Let me put you into the shoes of a recruiter or hiring manager doing these interviews. When they chat with you, Priya, what are the two things they're looking for more than anything else in that conversation?
They are looking for demonstrated experience and examples of what they are highlighting in the job, right? Mm-hmm. And they are also looking for, you know, the why I want to join the company, which, you know, translates into manifesting passion for the role itself, but also for the company.
Yeah, you nailed it, Priya. According to your colleagues on the other side of the river, over at that other school that starts with an H, their sociologists have said, hey, when any human being sits down to evaluate another human being, it tends to come back to two things over and over again, across countries, across cultures. Number one is competence. Can you do the job? Do you know what you're talking about? But number two, just as importantly, warmth. Would I want to do the job with you? Are you going to be a good fit with us? And so Priya, I want to show you and every one of these MIT alums how to nail each of these dimensions. Let's start with competence because I think it's a little bit easier. If you were going to put together some great answers to get ready, you got to start with the questions, the things you expect to get. If you want to figure out what the most likely questions are for an HR business partner role, how would you find them?
For me, it's not been yet through ChatGPT, but I have been on the other side of the table and, you know, have interviewed as well. So I'm just basing it off of, you know, all the interviews that I'm doing and kind of being prepared for those questions, because they aren't that many different questions. They are pretty much, there is a trend that you can do, can make out once you've attended a few interviews.
That's right. They're always going to say, tell me about yourself. Tell me about a time you influenced the team. There's going to be certain things that come up again and again. But what I would argue to you is that, again, the job description is the source of truth, because that's actually what the hiring manager and the recruiter are putting together to basically say, this is what we care about. This is the value we're looking for. So let's start with this HR business partner at Boston Children's Hospital. How cool is that? Using your HR skills for good. Yeah.
So Jeremy, you know, I would be looking for something a bit more experience.
Oh, okay. Wise.
Yeah. So maybe you put in senior director, HR partner, or something like that.
Yeah, absolutely. And just to be clear, this is only an example. What I really want to train everyone to do is not to worry so much about the exact keywords for one job, but to know how to find them themselves the next time. So let's just roll with this as a little bit example. But yeah, okay. Federal Reserve, senior HR leader. Again, we're going to grab the job description. I would love everyone to try this right now. Search for your own dream job, grab the JD, and come back to our friend ChatGPT. You say, what are the 10 most likely interview questions for this JD? And we're going to paste it in one last time. I'm putting the prompt right into the chat because I want everyone to try this. And then we have the actual stuff that the hiring manager cares about, not just blah, blah, blah. Here's a behavioral question, but here's the stuff that I need done. Can you hack it? So Priya, as you suggested, you're going to get a healthy diet of behavioral questions in every single interview. Tell me about a time you did this. Can you provide an example of that? When you want to answer those questions with massive competence, how do you like to structure your answers, Priya? Are there any frameworks you draw upon?
So the framework I typically draw upon is this, you know, explaining the situation, explaining the process, but most importantly, ending with the impact it had on the business. So those are the three things I touch upon when answering a question like that.
Love it. And I think, you know, if you wanted to really boil it down, probably every great human story follows the same format, right? It's kind of that format that you may have learned when you were at MIT or another school. CAR, challenge, action, result. Think about every great story from the ancient texts all the way to Star Wars. What was the challenge? There was this guy, Darth Vader, who was going around the galaxy, blowing up planets. What was the heroic action? Luke Skywalker risks life and limb to fly into the Death Star. And what was the result, to your point, Priya? Bringing peace and prosperity back to the galaxy. That happy ending.
Yeah.
Priya, check this out. You know who else knows about CAR? Our friend ChatGPT. We say, generate an answer to number 3 using the CAR format and drawing from my CV. Now we're actually going to bring 3 things together. The world of the hiring manager, what they want, our world based on our CV, and then the CAR format that allows us to be super focused on what they care about. And this is the thing that blows my mind. When I was back in grad school, Priya, I probably spent 20 hours taking an Excel sheet and putting in C, A, R, coming up with all these stories. ChatGPT can do all of that work in 20 seconds. So I hope everyone can try that out. And now, I know we're down to our last 2 minutes, so I've got one last question, Priya. I think any smart MIT grad or grad from any school can figure out how to be competent, but how in the heck do you figure out how to be warm even if you feel so cold on the inside?
You know, that's when I look at the LinkedIn profile ahead of time of the interviewer, the recruiter, or hiring manager, whoever it is. And typically you can, you know, glean a lot from people posting on LinkedIn, and also just I Google and ensure that if there are any posts or, you know, webinars or podcasts they've done, I listen to it and find some areas where I can sort of relate to them. And like the last interview I had, the gentleman had a screensaver with his Bernese Mountain Dog, and I have a Bernie Doodle. And so, you know, that was a conversation starter and an icebreaker, right? So I think there's just ways of doing it. Sometimes even with all of that, it does not click, right? And I've had that happen to me as well.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, you know, we have to accept that we're not going to be able to control every situation. But it turns out that for people who are in high stress situations all the time, as opposed to the occasional interview, there is a technique that tends to get them really well prepared. And it's not just going through the motion and doing, you know, regular old practice, having a friend interview. Instead, it's something called deliberate practice. And there's this famous psychologist, Anders Ericsson, who basically studied chess grandmasters, tennis champions, prima ballerinas, and they all practiced in a really specific way that was focused on not just going through the motions and building in these bad techniques, but getting specific feedback after every practice on how they can improve. And I would argue to everyone out there, no matter how introverted you might feel, and I'm an introvert by nature, there is a way to bring out your absolute best if you get the coaching you need. And check this out, Priya. There is the deliberate practice interview simulator built right into LinkedIn, and it's free. So everyone, I know you got to run. No worries if we're at time. But if you can stay for an extra minute or two, check out this link. And what you can do in this interview prep tool is you can grab any question. So a question that's generic, a question that's specific to a certain kind of role, and then get 2 powerful gifts. Gift number 1 is the gift of self-awareness. How can you possibly control the warmth that you're projecting if you don't know what it's like to be on the other side of your answer? And so this gives you the same thing the professional athletes have, which is the understanding of how you're coming across. And number 2, go for it, Priya. Yeah.
Sorry, where did you go for this?
Absolutely. Yeah. So I put the link into the chat, but I will show you one more time how to get there. I'll just mention before we go that what it gives you is the same thing that a great coach gives you, not just be warmer, Priya, be more charismatic, which is not very helpful, but instead, hey, Priya, maybe slow down your speaking a little bit. Maybe start to vary your pitch a little bit more to engage the listener. Maybe watch out for those filler words that trip us all up, those ums and ahs that detract from our speech. And not only that, you can take that exact same video and you can share it with your folks over at MIT, You could share it with an MIT alum inside the company to see how you match up to the company's values. And again, this is all free. You do not need LinkedIn Premium through the link in the chat or by coming to Jobs right here at the top and then Interview Prep. How does that sound, Priya?
That sounds pretty awesome.
Cool. Well, Priya, you are awesome. And you have definitely brought great honor to all the spouses, partners, and family members of the MIT community because you rocked this session. Thank you so much, Priya.
Thank you, Jeremy. This has been incredibly helpful.
Oh, my pleasure. Thank you for joining. Okay, I know folks have to run, so here's what we're going to do. I'm going to share a couple of quick bonus goodies because I want you to have those before you leave. However, if you've got questions that you want to ask, we can definitely keep going for a couple more minutes. So put those in the Q&A. Now, for those who have to run, a couple things. Number one, I'm always discovering new hacks, new techniques. And of course, as a huge LinkedIn nerd, someone who used to work there, I always share them on LinkedIn. So if you want to get first dibs on all those goodies, just follow me over here on LinkedIn. And if you want a book like Priya did, go to more, go to connect, send me a note. And oh, by the way, it's totally okay to have AI generate the message. That being said, if you didn't win a print copy, fear not, you can actually get a free digital copy courtesy of our friends over at Amazon. So here's the trick. You come over to Amazon, you sign up for a free trial of Kindle Unlimited or Audible if you want the audiobook version. You download the book and you cancel right away, but you keep the book forever, courtesy of me and our buddy Jeff Bezos. And then finally, one last crazy thing that I want to end with tonight. And that is, I'm going to take you way back to the digital stone ages, 2011 to be specific. I was probably the only former kindergarten teacher at the Apple Developer Conference in San Francisco. But it was actually a really sort of famous conference in retrospect because it was Steve Jobs' final keynote. And that morning in San Francisco, even though he was already sick, he was so charismatic, so warm on that stage that he kept going past his final slide and even pulled one more slide out with those famous last words, one more thing. And on that morning in July of 2011, Steve introduced the world to Siri for the very first time. Now, I know that Siri is not looking too hot by comparison to ChatGPT these days, but I still fundamentally believe there is a direct line between the world that Steve ushered in that morning and the world we live in right now. So in honor of Steve, in honor of Siri, I've got one more thing for you, and I call it CareerBot 3000. Here's how it works. You come into this spreadsheet over here, just a simple old Google sheet, and you say, hey, I want to build not just a path to a job, but a path to a great career and a great life. So I've got to start with some important values. I might say, I really need a job with creativity, but I also want to build upon the analytical skills I built up at MIT, and I want a chance to relocate to Boston to get back in touch with my roots. And then with your values in place, you give ChatGPT everything you need to know about your background and your skills. And it starts to think about those Venn diagram bubbles that we started with. Here's what's possible out in the world. Here's what fits your goals. And then if there's a certain role that feels right to you, here are the keys to the kingdom, the keywords to beat the ATS, a taste of what the job is like to see if it's right for you. And then advice from your resume to your cover letter, all the way to the interview room, so you have everything you need to go out there and rock the world. And this is yours for free forever through the link in the chat, because I want you to live out Steve's famous last words for us, which is, hey, it's a new year, it's 2024. There is so much opportunity in front of us with all these tools, with this incredible world we're living in. There is no reason that we can't go out there and make a big honking dent in the universe. So here's wishing you a fantastic start to the new year and many exciting adventures ahead. Thank you all so much. Okay, so I'm gonna pause for a moment. Lourdes, should we take a few questions or do you wanna wrap up? What's your feeling?
No, this has been absolutely amazing and so enjoyable. Thank you so much, Jeremy. If you have a few more minutes, we could take a few, you know, one or two more questions.
Yeah, absolutely. So here's a really juicy one from Parker. And Parker says, can we do a walkthrough of creating a draft of a cover letter that's curated to a specific role in a company? And I love that, Parker. Because again, I think we've all sort of fallen into that trap of saying, generate a cover letter. And then we get back this thing that is so generic, so useless, and we kind of give up. So here's the better approach. What I would say is, I would start by saying, here is my CV. I'm going to paste in my CV. Here is the JD I want to apply to. I'll just choose a generic one to get us started. Please generate a concise but personalized cover letter that focuses on what the employer wants. Okay, so that's going to get us off to the races here. So I'm expressing my strong interest in this role. You're looking for this person. This is my experience with it. But I find that in almost every case, what you get back is still way too long, way too robotic. So what I might say is, please reduce to 3 paragraphs and just focus on what the JD calls for. And that way we kind of avoid some of this blah, blah, blah that ChatGPT tends to do. Okay, now we've got a little shorter one and you can continue to refine it over and over. However, this is the hard part, Parker. I will tell you that at some point, you're gonna hit diminishing marginal returns where ChatGPT just can't get any more engaging, any better, because again, it's been trained on such generic text. So I think at that point, it's incumbent upon you, Parker, to come in and add that human touch. So maybe I put it into a Google Doc and I take out some of the things that feel really generic. And then I focus on the stories and the experiences and the numbers that are a little more sort of personalized, and then take it out of the realm of robot writing and make it writing that's really unique to me. So I would argue that ChatGPT, based on the way it's configured today, is not able to demonstrate just perfect writing from a whole cloth, but it can get you started, it can get you unstuck, and then you just have to finish that last mile of making it your own. Great question, Parker. Okay, Pragya says, when was the data about matching 50% of job requirements for an interview gathered? Great question, Pragya. So it was actually gathered, and this is interesting now, back in the Great Recession. And I know that feels like ancient history, but the reality is the Great Recession was an even tougher job market than the one that we're facing right now. So I would argue that no matter how daunting the economic environment is, the reality is that recruiters have very clear incentives. I've got to bring someone in who feels good, but doesn't feel like such an outlier that they're not going to take the job or they're going to be a poor fit in the interview. And so I would argue, even in good times, even in bad, that idea of not having to match every last keyword still holds. Great question, Pragya. Okay, let's see here. Timo says, oh, we got lots of questions about the 50%. I love that. Ah, any way that ChatGPT can specifically help workers with experience in one nation get a job in another? For example, a Chinese national who wants a US job. So I would argue, Persona, this is the kind of place where ChatGPT can do so much better than a generic Google search. If you were to say, how do I get a job in the US? It's going to give you all the stuff about immigration blogs and, you know, all these things that are really generic. But if you came in here and said, here is my CV, what is the best way for me to land a job in Canada as a US citizen, and I'll just paste in the CV one more time, what it can do is give you really personalized advice. And the thing is that, of course, it's not going to be the same as sitting down with an immigration lawyer. I would never claim that, but it's going to be so much more specific to your situation than just sort of going to Google and looking at a very generic approach. So again, I would say, don't worry so much about the specific applications. The big takeaway from this session is that you have tremendous power at your fingertips that did not exist in 2022 to really go out there and find an opportunity in the world that matches you and your passions. And it would be crazy not to take advantage of that. Now, with that said, I'm going to bring it back to Lourdes to wrap up this session and send us off into the good night.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Jeremy. This has been such an amazing session, so enjoyable. Thank you for sharing your energy, your knowledge, your insights, not only, you know, with this group, but with all the alumni around the globe, as this webinar will be available later on in about a couple of weeks. So on behalf of the MIT Alumni Association, we really are extremely grateful and appreciate your bringing your knowledge and your time. And thank you also for all the viewers who joined today. We've had an amazing audience. I also would like to thank specifically Richard, Leslie, and Priya for being part of the session and sharing with it. You've made it really something very memorable, and we look forward to learning more of this. Thank you so much, everybody. Good evening, good day, wherever you're joining us. Bye-bye.